Good afternoon, everyone. I'm your host, Carolina Moreno, and welcome to Build. Rita Moreno is a legendary actress, dancer, and singer, both on screen and on stage. She's also one of a handful of artists to win an Emmy, a Grammy, an Oscar, and a Tony. And if that wasn't enough, she also stars as the beautiful and charismatic Lydia Riera in Netflix's One Day at a Time. The critically acclaimed series' third season premieres this Friday. Let's see what's in store.
It was on a night like this when I debuted as a dancer and I wore my mommy's heels. And my lean calves looked like they had been chiseled out of marble. But when I stepped on the dance floor, I suddenly saw
my sister Marucci had also entered the competition.
I am so happy that I brought you into this world to laugh at me. Because of your giant heads, I pee when I cough.
That's okay. Everybody give a round of applause for Rita, please. Welcome, Rita. Thank you very much for being here.
She is the most delicious character. I just love her. I love Lydia.
And really, that scene just shows so much about what's so great about her.
Right? And what she thinks so much of herself. She thinks she's God's gift to men. She's so vain. I love playing all of that stuff. Yeah. That's good. That's good stuff for actors. Yeah. Love that.
And you've said that. You said, I love all her bad qualities.
Of course.
Why do you love all her bad qualities?
Because they're funny. They're hilarious. For one thing, she's always fooling herself. I mean, there's nothing more delicious than watching Lydia trying to get out of some kind of fix by lying, just barefaced lying. I love that about her.
Yeah.
And, of course, the other thing I really love is when Lydia... And Lupe, her daughter, have a fight. We are marvelous together. We have this great chemistry.
It's so great.
Justina Machado, whom I know you've interviewed.
She was here on Monday. Yeah, she was wonderful. She said wonderful.
And we're hilarious when we fight. We are so funny because we are very Latina.
And it really has that sense. I mean, as a Latina growing up, I'm like, this feels like my family when they're fighting. It feels exactly the same. It's almost like it's who can yell louder sometimes.
That's right. And you're always right, right?
And I'm always right every single time.
Of course.
Like you.
Yeah.
Morenos.
Like Lydia.
Morenos. Like. And one of the things that I love, love, love about Lydia, which is very present in this clip that we just saw, was essentially how sensual she is, right?
Oh, yeah. That's important.
Yeah.
You know, that was one of the conditions that I made when I met Norman Lear, who was the producer, who also did All in the Family and Maude and all kinds of great, great shows. I said, I know I don't mind playing at all an older woman. And I don't mind playing old. Mm-hmm. I'm 87, just so you know.
Woo.
So, but I said, the one thing I want Lydia to have, a quality that I want her to have, is that she be sexual. Because, you know, just because you're older doesn't mean that you're no longer womanly or sexy. Mm-hmm. That's ridiculous. You know, that's for kids. So they loved it. They loved the idea of it. The writers loved the idea of her being sexy. And, you know, she's shameless. She will flirt with a fence post.
I think I love that about her because she not only flirts and, you know, there is a storyline about her, you know, being able to let go of her husband, so to speak.
Yeah.
But then she also has, a love interest.
She flirts with Penelope's boyfriends.
Yes.
I mean, there's one episode, remember, where I'm feeling his bicep. he is a stallion.
And you have your own love interest, too, so to speak, in the show, right, Dr. Berkowitz?
Well, sort of, kind of.
Sort of.
I mean, he would love that, but we just go to the opera together.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
There's some great stuff in store for you with if you like Lydia for this season. There's some really funny, funny stuff.
Yeah. And one of the things that I was really excited to see the first episode
of the third season
was that you guys have guest stars, Gloria Estefan being one of them.
Yeah.
What was it like to be?
That's rare. That's rare because we try not to do that unless we really, really feel the need, because it's really about a family, and that we don't want it to turn into one of those sitcoms where stars kind of casually drop in. No, we really.
Yeah.
So, but Gloria is different because number one, She wrote the not wrote, but she sang the theme song, and it's very Latinized the way she does it. That's kind of different. Although I'm waiting one of these days for Andy Garcia to show up. No, because Lydia loves him.
Lydia loves him.
Yes, because one time her daughter says to her, "Are you wearing makeup?" Because she's wearing her nightgown. She says, "Are you wearing makeup?" She says, "Of course. I never know who I'm going to run into." She said, in your house?" She said, "Well, I don't know what Andy Garcia has in mind." So she mentions him a few times now and then. So I would be just delighted if she just went to pieces if he showed up on the set one day.
Well, Andy Garcia, if you're watching this, now that's your invitation to the set.
He knows.
And one of the things that I talked about with Justina about One Day at a Time is how so often it's seen as this Latino show, right? It's because it features Latinos and a Latino family, like it can only be seen by Latinos. And she just did not like that at all. She doesn't like that people see it that way, and she really wants to.
Well, I think people. We've attracted. Our audience keeps mm-hmm. growing. And it started certainly with Latinos, and why not? Mm-hmm. I mean, you don't see this very often. And what's happening is that a lot of non-Latino, non-Hispanic people, families to be precise, are watching it. They're watching it because it's a family show. Mm-hmm. It really is a family show. Except it's a family show with some serious exceptions, because the young daughter, my granddaughter, has come out as gay. Mm-hmm. Which is, you know, think of your family. Think of your family and how they would react. Mm-hmm. Not terrific, I'll bet you. I'll bet.
It's definitely a progressive show. I talked to Justina about how progressive it is. You know, the features.
Well, it's Norman Lear. Yeah. Norman Lear is a very progressive man. And we take on many, many, many serious social issues. Mm-hmm. And yet, these wonderful writers manage to make it funny. And then there's always something in the show, in that half hour, that makes you or your eyes tear up. And that's the best of all worlds, I think. So we can actually, as actors, we can really do some heavy-duty acting in it.
Yeah, you know, there is a mix of that drama, humor, and heart. And one of the things that Justina was saying, essentially, is that this is an American family.
It is.
You know, just like any other family out there. And the way that, you know, Latinos a lot of times related to seeing non-Latinos on screen, similarly, people can relate to Latinos.
Exactly. And also, you know, even Lydia is conversant with the YouTube and all that kind of stuff, except she calls it the YouTube. And she calls it Snap a Chop.
Snapchat.
Snap a Chop.
My favorite thing is Latinx being a Cuban Kleenex.
Oh, Latin.
It's a Cuban Kleenex.
That's right.
It's the best Kleenex, then.
That's right. And the cure-all for everything?
For everything.
Vaseline. No, what is it?
Viva Peru. Viva Peru. That's true. Vicks Vapor Rub will cure literally anything in a Latino household.
It's called Vaporub. That's how they pronounce it, Vaporub.
Yeah, that's true. And I want to congratulate Steven Spielberg for casting you in the West Side Story remake. So, yeah, so exciting. Amazing.
Can you believe that? You talk about going full circle.
Serious. And also you're executive producing as well.
I am also executive producing. I get credit for that. And I tell you, when I spoke to him for the first time on the phone, number one, I happen to think that Steven Spielberg is just a terrific director. He's one of my favorites. I think he's a bit of a genius. E.T. is still one of my favorite movies. And I tell you, when I was talking to him on the phone, I thought, oh, my God, I'm going to pee my pants. I'm dying. I was so excited. And, yes, I'm going to. And so you wonder, so what part are you going to play? Because it's just really mostly
kids. They made one for you, pretty much.
They made one for me. Doc's Candy Store is no longer Doc's. And I'm assuming that he passed away and his wife has taken over. Mm. And her name is Valentina.
Right. Valentina.
It's a pretty name.
It's pretty, yeah.
Yeah.
So Valentina's Candy Shop. So
it seems exactly.
Like it. Yeah. And it's so wonderful, and definitely feels, especially for the Latino community, that making you executive producer and such a big part of it is a step in the right direction.
Well, let me tell you something about that, because a lot of people have talked to me about that, and you know, what about the wearing makeup that was too dark when you're not that color and all that? All of that is being addressed by Steven Spielberg and Tony Kushner. They know that there were certain things that were not really right in that movie, and one of them is that. But most important, perhaps, is that the sharks are now completamente Puerto Ricanos. They are all Puerto Rican.
Yeah. That's amazing.
Now, you know, I said to Steven on the phone when I first talked to him, I said, you know, it's wonderful if we can find Puerto Rican people, but this is really the story of Romeo and Juliet. Yeah, people forget that. And Juliet was a very young girl in Romeo and Juliet. She was about the age of the girl who's going to play her, which is fantastic. Natalie Wood was young. She was a woman. And I was really too old to play Anita. I was supposed to be a teenager in my dreams. But there's all kinds of really good things happening in that respect. They are very, very aware. They even went so far as to call the University of Puerto Rico.
Yeah, I was going to talk to you about that. Yeah. So, well, for to clear up what we were talking about just now, essentially, in the original, there was some of the actors had their face darkened, including you, which was you've talked about as well.
I remember saying to the, you know, Puerto Ricans are many colors because we were colonized by so many countries. We're colonized by the Dutch, by the French, and by Spaniards, Spain. So we are, and then Taino Indian. That's probably where I get my dark eyes. And that color is probably sort of a copper color. And so I remember saying to my makeup man one day, I'm so sick of having this muddy makeup on me because I'm so fair compared to the color you're putting on me. It shines through the makeup, so you have to really put it on thick.
Cake it on.
And he said to me, what are you, a racist?
No, I'm Puerto Rican.
Great. Yeah, that's right. I'm Puerto. I should have said that. I was so shocked that he said that that I just shut up. I was astonished at that. But we are many colors.
Yeah.
And that's how it should be. If they're tan, great. If they're beige, that's terrific. If they're pink, that's also fine because they're still what they're supposed to be.
Yeah.
And that's what's very important that's being added to the movie. Yeah. You didn't see that in the original West Side Story.
And one of the things that you just mentioned was that the Spielberg, he went to the University of Puerto Rico and kind of, you know, held a town hall. One of the things that people brought up in that town hall was concerns about the remake and the timing, essentially, because obviously Puerto Rico has been going through a tough time these recent years, Hurricane Maria, economically. And for them, it was a time, you know, for them, they had concerns about possible stereotyping, much like in the original, obviously painting Puerto Ricans as gang members, and also certain lines in the musical, you know, that were kind of dismissive of the island.
You know, the original idea was to do an East Side Story. And it would be Jews and non-Jews. That was the very original one. And there's several things that people really have to get over. There are Puerto Rican gangs. Just like there are white gangs, just like there are black gangs. There is such a thing. And they are taking what is known as the Romeo and Juliet story, which was two different kind of nationalities, the Capulets and the Montagues and the Capulets.
Right. Two families.
So I think it was a brilliant idea. But if you know, if you've got issues, well, I said to Steven Spielberg, I said, listen, get used to it. There's always going to be somebody who has an agenda. And no matter how hard you try, somebody's not going to like something. And we just have to get used to it. And yes, I think I'm a conduit to understanding that there's nothing in there that's going to offend, really offend. If you're offended because Anita says, Puerto Rico, my heart's devotion, let it sink back in the ocean. Well, that's her feeling about Puerto Rico. It does not, it's funny how people, I think, want to misread that. It's her opinion. She doesn't want to go back to Puerto Rico. Okay. I mean, that's too bad. It's sad because it's such a gorgeous island. But people misunderstand and they think that that's what the movie stands for. It isn't. That's just Anita who says, I don't ever want to go back to that island. Mm-hmm. I wasn't happy there. Fine. But the George Chakiris, who plays Bernardo, he tells her off all the time. And he says, you know, that's the way you see it. Mm-hmm. So people really have to get used to that. It's the actor portraying an opinion of something. They don't want to go back there. Mm-hmm. That's her right.
And one of the things that the original film did give the Latino community, but mostly you, was an Oscar, which is a momentous occasion for the community and for you. Amazing.
But, you know, people forget not only an Oscar, I got the Golden Globe.
The Golden Globe, yes.
I got the Golden Globe, also for playing Anita.
Yes. For the Oscars, though, I've seen tapes of the speech that you gave, which is you
what
pretty much...
speech?
You were speechless.
I really was. I find it so embarrassing. I was so sure I wasn't going to win that I didn't prepare. I was so sure that Judy Garland was going to win because it was Best Featured Actor, and in either a musical or a drama. And she was in a drama called Judgment at Nuremberg. Mm-hmm. And I was sure. And I flew all the way from Manila, the Philippines, to the Oscars just in case. And we swept the Oscars that night. What a night.
What a night. I'm sure. I can't even imagine
But I got to tell you, Puerto Rico went crazy. I got to tell you. I've been told, because obviously I wasn't there, but I'm told, Liz Torres told me this, so I get goosebumps when I think of it. There was screaming and yelling. That little island was just shaken. Se la comió!
You did it. It felt probably like a win for the whole entire
life. Oh, man, what a night. A night.
I can't imagine. I want to have, we have a question from Twitter, which is great, and here... Are there any similarities between you and Lydia besides you both being icons, of course?
Well, I don't even know that Lydia is an icon, but I have that kind of energy, yes. I'm not a vain person. I really am not a vain, even though I've got about 4 pounds of makeup on right now. But that's what I do when I do television. I'm really not like her, but her accent is my mama's. My mommy, who would say things like, I'm going to change the shits on the bed. Or, we're going to go swimming at the beach. Or when she met my husband-to-be, the guy who I was madly in love with, Leonard Gordon, who was a nice Jewish doctor. Mm-hmm. And when she met him, she said, so, Jew out of you, huh? I know it sounds like stand-up comedy, doesn't it? No. I'm not being John Leguizano. This is my life. And I remember he was so shocked. He said, what? And she said, I drew you.
That's wonderful. And we also have some questions from the audience, so I want to give them time to ask some questions.
Who wants to know what?
Right here.
Hi. I wanted to know what your initial reaction was to finding out that Spielberg was doing West Side Story.
You know, I was nervous about it. I'm glad you asked, because I thought, well, how do you redo an iconic movie like that, number one? Number two, what happens to the music? If you're going to do a 2002 version, because I didn't know, nobody knew, then that's going to mean rap, right? And I thought, what's going to happen to the music and the songs? And then are we going to be doing rap dances or something? I had no idea that I was going to be in it. And break dancing and all that kind of stuff. So I was a little nervous about it. And then when they said that Tony Kushner, who's this great playwright who wrote Angels in America, this great play, was going to do the script, I thought, well, that's going to be very serious, I think. So I didn't know what to think, but I was a little nervous about it. And now, you know, that I've spoken to Stephen many, many times, and that I've realized how much he cares. He really, really, really cares. He wants this to be representative. Yes, it's a gang, but so is the gang is white. I mean, are we then going to have Puerto Ricans and white people saying, they're gangs. Yeah, well, that is life, too. That's part of living. And that it's based on Romeo and Juliet, I think, is brilliant. It's absolutely brilliant. It's a great idea.
Do we have another question from the audience? Yes, we do.
Hello.
Hello. Your career has just been wonderful.
Isn't it crazy?
I've just loved everything. But with the list of awards through all those genres of entertainment, was there one that really gave you, like, more satisfaction than the others? One that you said,
well,
I made it?
You bet. The Oscar.
Yes.
You can't beat the Oscar. Now, there is one that's very close that I have also won. I like to think earned, and that's the Kennedy Center honor. That's pretty big. That's big. That is grande. Yeah. That's huge.
And you also have a President's Medal of Freedom as well, right?
I have the Presidential Medal of Freedom. I have shelves
all.
Of stuff. Yeah.
Green Actors Guild Lifetime Achievement Award.
Lifetime Achievement Award.
I could just
Award,
go on.
Which Morgan Freeman presented to me. And then last year I presented the same thing to him, Lifetime Achievement Award.
Wow.
And I remember, did you watch that by any chance? Did any of you see that
no.
SAG Award? Because it was really funny.
We have
because,
somebody.
because he came on stage when I said, and here he is, Morgan Freeman, the winner of Lifetime Achievement Award. And he comes up on the stage and he's wearing a very elegant baseball cap, but it's like in black satin. But he's wearing it really low. And he starts, it's like this. And he starts to do his acceptance speech, and I'm saying to myself, oh, my God, they can't see his face. This is terrible. What am I going to do? And I just interrupted his acceptance speech. I'm saying, Morgan, Morgan. And he's not paying. I say, Morgan. I said, your cap, they can't see your face. And he says, you see what I've had to put up with for 50 years?
Oh, I do remember.
Because we did the electric company together.
Yes.
So we've known each other for 50 years.
Yes.
And that it was like his mama and the kid. And he was the kid.
Perfect. And we do have one more question.
Hello.
Hi.
Of the many roles in your career, which one has taught you the most about yourself?
Ooh, like
oh, what a good question.
Thank you.
And you probably won't be surprised that it was West Side Story. And I'll tell you a little story about something that happened during the filming of the movie. We were doing the scene in the candy store when the Jets practically attack her and they're pulling her skirt up and they're calling her pig and Bernardo's tramp, Bernardo's pig, and they're really abusing her. We used to call that the rape scene because it's a near rape scene when they lift this young boy, baby John, and they're going to lower him on top of her. And the doc stops that from happening. And we rehearsed it and rehearsed it and rehearsed it. And that was choreographed. Just like a dance. It had steps. It just didn't look like it was dance steps, but it had those. And we must have rehearsed that for, oh gosh, about 3 hours before we filmed it. And somewhere in the third hour, it was just too much for me, and somebody was pulling at my hair, and I started to cry. And I ran to the candy store counter and sat on one of those stools and put my head on my arm, and I could not stop crying. And it still gets to me when I talk about it because I've been abused so much in some ways, just for being Latina and Puerto Rican. Oh my God! Wow.
Yeah.
And I've been called terrible names, you know, spick and garlic mouth and gold tooth. And it's as though this old wound, which I thought was closed, was a scar, opened up all over again in this situation. And, you know, the boys were just out beside themselves because they kept saying, Rita, oh, Rita, you know we love you. You know we love you. Oh, my God, this is terrible. The audience is going to hate us. Please, please don't cry. And I couldn't stop. And I couldn't stop so badly that the director, Robert Weiss, called an early lunch, and I went to my dressing room and just cried it out until there was nothing left. And but you can see, isn't that weird?
Did you
how
realize
some things
that,
hurt you so much?
Did you realize it right then that that's what it was?
That's what you asked. What it taught me.
Yeah.
It taught me that I still had to get tougher. It told me that I had to stand up to that And the only reason it got to me is because I really did believe that I didn't have any value, and that I didn't have any worth. And that's why I let it get to me. And so I went back into psychotherapy. I was in therapy for almost 8 years, in and out, because I worked a lot. But it's the best thing I ever did for myself was psychotherapy. I can't get over the fact that I just got teary. I thought it was over. Crazy?
I'm also in therapy, and one of the things that I've learned is that you just keep
it
learning.
It doesn't mean
more
you're
more
crazy. Right.
No.
Tell your family.
Yeah.
Because all Puerto Ricans say, está loca.
Yeah.
She is crazy.
Yeah. That's something
only
that,
crazy people go into that therapy stuff.
And that's something that One Day at a Time really touches upon a lot, and
I admire. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, it tells a lot. Isn't that marvelous?
Yeah.
That's right, because she suffers from depression.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, all those things that are so serious in life, that show takes on.
Yeah.
It's fantastic. I'm so proud to be in that show.
Yeah. And for everybody who wants to see the show, first and second season are on Netflix already, but the third season premieres this Friday.
This Friday.
So please, and everybody give a round of applause for Rita Moreno. Thank you so much for being here. I really appreciate your time.